This engine was used to pump natural gas when the wellhead pressure was too low to move the gas down the line. They would use sometimes two of these pumps in tandem. This one is rated 250 pounds pressure. They might use another one to raise the pressure higher. This engine is one of two that were shipped to Collins, New York by rail, and then hauled on horse-drawn freight wagons to the Zora Valley gas field 10 miles away. And there's some pictures over here in the information building of this center section here, which weighs 40 tons, being pulled by 10 horses down into the gas field. The engine was used at the Zora Valley gas field until 1941, when it was dismantled and taken to West Seneca, New York, and there it was used to pump gas from a coke processing plant, and that gas was mixed with the natural gas. The engine was taken out of service finally in 1976. I'll give you some specs on the engine. The pump down on this end could pump 180,000 cubic feet per hour at 120 RPM. As I said, it was 250 pounds working pressure. The engine burned 4,000 cubic feet of natural gas per hour, which seems like a lot, but that's only a little over 2% of what it was pumping. The engine has a 20-inch bore and 36-inch stroke. That adds up to 41,000 cubic inches. Develops 400 horsepower and 26,000 foot-pounds of torque. The engine is 60 feet long and weighs 100 tons. The flywheel is 12 and a half feet across, and it weighs 12 tons by itself. The engine is a horizontal design. The piston in this area and also down there, the piston fires both sides. It's designed as much like a steam engine. It's a double acting cylinder. So in effect, you have a four-cylinder engine and it's a four-stroke engine. So how did an engine that was dismantled up in New York get here to the Florida Flywheelers? Well, Mr. Ed Witter, who was a collector of all things mechanical, tractors and anything that was mechanical, had two of these engines that were in his dismantling yard, and he offered one of them to the Florida Flywheelers if they would guarantee to get it operational. So in the mid-90s, several semi-loads of rusty iron arrived here at Flywheelers Park. First thing they had to do was pour the base. Now there's 100 yards of concrete in this base. They had the blueprints for laying out the base, which had to be very exact because it had to support the engine exactly. 3.5 years after they began work, that group of volunteers had the engine completely assembled. I'd like to introduce Fred. He is one of the original volunteers on this engine. And we wouldn't have this engine here if it wasn't for the black group. Give him a hand. So how does the engine work? Well, we have several systems here, which I'll explain to you. We're getting ready to fire it up. Dave's going to turn on the ignition. You pre-charge the accumulator tank. That gives the engine a good gulp of gas for starting. Engage the dog clutch. We start the engine with compressed air. About the third revolution, it will be running. Oh, on this engine is controlled by this coil box here. There are 8 coils in that box. Each cylinder has 2 igniters. 2 here, same down on the other end. This engine does not have spark plugs, they're just a make and break igniter. They fire the gas in this pre-combustion chamber, that fires the gas in the cylinder. The orange pipes are fuel. The green pipes are water for cooling. It does have a water jacket through the length of the engine. This shaft here, you see, cycling, is hollow. So there's water running down through the center of that shaft. That cools the pistons. After it runs a few minutes, you'll see steam coming off the water that's coming out the other end. These lines here go to the exhaust valve. There's water going into the exhaust valve to keep it cool. This is an exhaust valve right here. This is an intake valve. These are the mixing valves or carburetors. The air intake is on the other side of the carburetor where you really can't see it. For lubrication, we have about 3 different systems here. These pumps are operated off of the camshaft. That's lubricating the valves and the cylinders. These drip oilers are lubricating the valve stem. This large tank up here in the rafters is gravity feeding oil to all the bearings on the engine. This rotating unit up here is the governor. That controls the speed of the engine. The rated speed is 120 RPM. We'll run it at half speed here, about 60 RPM. We do know that there's a safety in the flywheel. If this should overspeed, there's a pin that'll pop out by centrifugal force. It pops this lever back, throws a light switch, which shuts off the ignition. And we know that that is very effective because 2 years ago, this show, there was frost on the ground in the morning. And the oil was thick and sticky. And the governor stuck and she took off. And it does get your heart racing a little bit. But it did shut down. And we just controlled the gas flow to keep the RPMs down and went on. This linkage is connected from the governor to the carburetor. That's how it controls the speed. The far end of the engine is the compressor. That's a double acting pump down there. We have the poppet valves turned out so that that is not actually compressing anything. They've opened the valve down there so you can hear it pumping, but it's not really pumping any pressure. That is a double acting pump. The piston pumps both directions. We've got an external roller cam here. The load on this cam controls both the exhaust valve and the intake valve. Little cam here controls the ignition. And I tell you, folks that got hot rods, you think you've got something special because you got a roller cam. This thing's 103 years old that's got a roller cam. These are the exhaust manifolds. They go down to a pipe set underground. The exhaust is in a large stack over in that far corner. You step outside, you can hear the firing of the engine in that stack. extent of my presentation. If you have some questions, we'd be happy to try to answer them for you. The can here is an oil pump which we are not actually using. This unit here is an oil reclamation unit. Has filters in it. When it was used in the field, they filtered the oil and recycled it. Here we just collect the oil and take it to recycling at the machine shop. This engine does not have a frame case. All the oil is either pressure or drip, and we catch the excess oil that runs off of the engine. That's a good question. How did they make a flywheel that day? Pretty amazing how to work with this thing that whole lifetime.
Yeah. got an explanation of the overspeed safety system on this engine. In the flywheel, there is a spring-loaded pin in there that's retracted right now. If the engine runs too fast, that pin will pop out. And when it does, from centrifugal force, it catches this arm. That arm is in line with the pin. And by releasing the catch right there, allowing the weight to fall, the circuit is broken. And that will disable the ignition system. And that would be if the governor were stuck or something were wrong and the engine was trying to run away to the damage point, that would save it. There's a close-up of the low-tension ignition system, igniter system. As you can see, the wire is going inside the cylinder into the combustion chamber. When the cam is running and the small cam lobe is gripping the lever, it causes the movable contact inside the combustion chamber to make and break contact. Therefore, it's the breaker point and the spark plug in one. Another interesting thing, this is the exhaust valve spring down here. Exhaust rocker arm, and exhaust valve spring. Those two hoses are water cooling for the exhaust valve. It's hollow and water cooled. This is a spare exhaust valve. This is the seat where it actually seals the combustion gases. The valve stem itself is hollow. And those hoses that we just saw, one of them has a tube up into the head where the water is discharged and flows back down the stem and out around the periphery of the tube to cool the exhaust valve. The intake valve here is simpler. It's not water cooled.
Dog bed, it puts it in time, get a cam here.
Yep. It engages the air distributor so it'll turn with the engine cam.
So that it'll dump the air into the correct cylinder?
Yep.
That's on the power stroke.
Yeah.
Alright.
The air valves are in here, right? The rotating valve spool?
Yes, sir.
Directs the air to the side. That's okay, I can get it from here. Okay.
And this shows you the pressure being fed to the unit.
Okay.
One-way check valve.
Okay. Cool. I'll go around back and see where those pipes go in the engine. Get that. So here, following the air line to the direct air starting, and that's the injection point. Four combustion chambers, so there's four air injection points. And of course, the piston rod is withstanding compression and combustion gases on the inside of the cylinder. So that's got a heck of a seal in it there on all these points. Since it's a double acting engine. Now the piston rod is water cooled internally, and this sliding joint is where the water is actually entering into the piston rod. To cool the system. Pistons are cooled by water, goes all the way through the rod, and then the final point of discharge is right there where you see the water coming out. That's the spent cooling water. It's an amazing piece of engineering. Truly amazing. And these guys are so dedicated to keep it running. Only runs a few times a year, and I was fortunate to be here this time. Get a view of the compressor end. Normally the natural gas will be connected to these ports, the two big ports, but since this is just set up for demonstration, we don't have that.